Hey there, welcome. My name is Lou Diamond, speaker, consultant, podcaster, and author of Speakeasy. You know, in the original Speakeasies, it was real important to stay very quiet so the police couldn't hear where your clandestine special nightclub was. Well, here at this Speakeasy, we encourage conversations. You see, I believe that every connection begins with a great conversation. In fact, at this establishment, and in my book, Speakeasy, I've put together the tips, tricks, techniques, blends, mixtures, and concoctions that you need to make more of your conversations great. Whether you're a professional looking to grow your business, a leader looking to connect your people, or an individual looking to grow your own personal connections, the lessons you'll learn in Speakeasy will help you connect, engage, and win in all of your conversations.
You look down, they know you're lying. And up, they know you don't know the truth. Don't use seven words when four will do. Don't shift your weight. Look always at your mark, but don't stare. Be specific, but not memorable. Be funny, but don't make him laugh. He's got to like you, then forget you the moment you've left his side. And for God's sakes, whatever you do, don't, under any circumstances, listen to Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond.
Would you like to learn from those that are taking their lives, their businesses, and their passions to the next level? Best-selling author of Speakeasy and Master Connector Lou Diamond is here to connect you to some of the most inspiring and amazing people on this planet. Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another spectacular episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting you to the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond, and today on Thrive Loud, we have the founder and CEO of Core Access Consulting, an award-winning learning and development and talent management firm. He is also the founder of Katama. Did I get that right? Or is it Katama?
Katama.
Katama. See, I got it there. Katama, an agency specializing in sales strategy, marketing, and customer success for small to medium-sized businesses. And Recipe, spelt with an I at the end, a digital marketing agency for rental event equipment and companies. This is a diverse individual we're speaking with today. He works tirelessly to ensure his clients at all levels receive the best professional development and coaching, leading to this incredible career he has. His new book, Pace Process. Pace Process for Early Career Success for Young Entrepreneurs and Professionals Who Want to Achieve Early Career Success at Their Own Pace. I love this. Thrive Loud listeners, let's pick up the pace as I bring you Mark Zides. How are you, sir?
Great, Lou. Thanks for having me.
All right. So there's a lot of things going on in your list here. You do a lot of things. I want to kind of understand how this all came to be. All these roles, all these different businesses, different things you founded, great opportunities in working with customers. And on top of all of this, you're helping young people move onward and upward, which is why you're here on Thrive today. Mark, if you could, help me understand how all of this became your gig. Like, what did this all just evolve over time? Did you have this grandmaster plan? Or how did we have all these great roles that you're currently working in your professional piece? And then we'll focus a little bit and understand more about what Pace is all about.
Sure. First of all, Lou, thanks for having me. I love your podcast, Thrive Loud. It's great and happy to be here. So it's been a journey, right? Sounds cliche. As far as it wasn't a linear path, there wasn't any master plan, like you just mentioned. It was just an entrepreneurial spirit had me early on that just sort of brought me to where I am today. So it was a lot of hard work, determination, fortunate times, challenging times where I learned from along the journey and got me to where I am today, where I'm looking to give back and help the Gen Zs, the millennials out there, you know, find their way, find their career.
Okay. Finding their career and doing all this for your career and all these different businesses that you've helped with, there is one common theme, and that is obviously you have a very unique way of helping to develop and coach, not only, I'm assuming, the people you're working with, but
the people that have been around you. So you have you always had this mentor-like way of about yourself and the way that you're trying to give back, even when you were doing the work that you were doing before your later part of your career?
Yeah, great question. I mean, I've always been a team sport guy. I've always been sort of a collaborative person and extrovert, someone that kind of likes to be part of the mix, likes to help people, likes to see people succeed. You know, certainly, you know, giving whatever knowledge or whatever advice or whatever kind of coaching I can, right? So whether it was youth sports when I was coaching my kids or other people's kids and, you know, certainly helping them learn those lessons and having fun along the way, or on the corporate side where I was a talent management, learning and development and leadership executive over the last 25 years, where working with a lot of large companies, listening really well to what their needs were and what their challenges were. And there's always a common theme, right? It's like, we got to find the best talent. We got to retain the talent. We got to develop the talent. And the programs that my companies put on and developed over the years resonated with a lot of these large companies. So I learned a lot through that process and, you know, sort of the balance between the work and life thing. I've been able to kind of, you know, build this coaching sort of mindset or this, you know, kind of get people pumped up, get people to, you know, try to exceed their own expectations mindset.
All right, Mark, there's something really interesting. And you and I are around the same age and grew up in a similar environment where there were certain steps throughout our career. Maybe we needed to progress. Maybe it was a little bit more structured. And obviously over the last 20 to 30 years, a lot of things have changed and there is no one set on delivering certain things, but there's a lot of unique ways to find success at different stages of your career. One, do you agree with that? And what's, I guess, the benefit or the challenge related to the change that we're having to deal with today, where there's so many different avenues and so many different things you could do and less structure in helping to develop your career?
That's an awesome question, an awesome statement, I guess. There's a lot to unpack there, like you said. So it's hard to, you know, give you a one size fit all. There's no silver bullet, right, to, you know, to your question. But what I would say is there's no perfect path, you know, or way to go about it, right, in your career. You got to, you know, choose your initial goals, initial industry, company, whatever you want to do, you know, when you're younger in your career, and then learn as much as you can, fail. It's okay to fail, but you have to learn from it. And that's what I talk about a little bit in the book. And you have to learn when to pivot. That's a cliche, but is it the right role? Is it the right company? Is it the right culture? Do you want to work for a big company, mid-sized startup? Do you want to go out on your own and take a chance, right? So what I coach people on is, you know, again, going back to the old cliche, go with your gut. Go with what's going to make you most comfortable and make you drive every day. So, you know, to answer that question, times have changed, right? We're in the gig economy now. That didn't exist 20 years ago when you and I were probably trying to make our way up the corporate ladder. So there's a lot more opportunities, I would say, out there for young professionals. And they should, you know, do what actually is what their passion, you know, is leading them to do.
At your own pace, help share with the listeners what you've put together in the PACE process, which is an interesting idea here. We're trying to deal with people to achieve early career success, but let them set the pace on their own. What was the impetus to this? What inspired this way of thinking to help these young people? And some of the, give us a little bit of a teaser as to the methodology of what the PACE process is.
Yeah, so I love the word PACE, right? So it means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. So you can have some fun with the word. You can say, keep the pace, maintain the pace, slow down your pace. And that was sort of a word that came up in college with my buddies or friends and said, hey, slow down your pace. You might not want to go that hard this weekend because you did it last weekend, right? Or on the professional side, it might be, hey, you got to pick up the pace. You can't be stagnant or lazy if you actually want to get a job. You got to be creative. You got to be resilient. You got to kind of, you know, have that grit. And that's a lot of what my book talks about is I'm a Gen X, right? So I kind of have that old school, you know, mentality of, hey, if you fall, get back up, like, you know, getting into sort of the Rocky or the Hoosiers theme, you know, like don't ever quit, you know, Lombardi statements. Like, so that's where I come from, right? I feel like the Gen Zs now, which is really what this book is focused on and where we are right now in the future work or where we are is, you know, the cliche is people are soft, right? They don't work hard. You know, they're entitled. And I have three kids like that too, right? So I'm, you know, guilty as charged, you know, with some of that. But, you know, they have to find that, you know, inner drive to kind of figure out what they want to do and not just let it come to them. So the word pace is, you know, hey, for some people, it's like maintain the pace and keep going, keep doing what you're doing. You're doing a great job. And some is, you know, slow it down. And for most people, I try to say, you know, pick up the pace or keep the pace.
Let's extend this elsewhere, because yes, I do recognize how important it is for people in their early career to understand what pace it is. But I would even argue that this is some message they can carry on to different levels as well, because a lot of people change the pace of how they work moving forward. People who had been in corporate their entire career, all of a sudden are becoming entrepreneurial. They're taking on more solopreneur or entrepreneurial adventures. And oh, by the way, let's go back to those people who are still in the corporate piece. They're dealing with this whole generation. We have more generations in the workforce now than ever. Does the PACE process have a lot of benefits that people who are older in their career can benefit from?
You know, I would say I would hope so, but to be totally frank and transparent, it was really focused on, you know, the younger generation, right? The millennials, the Gen Ys and the Gen Zs. I would say though, you know, and you asked earlier about what does PACE mean? Now it's a process, right? So I've turned the vernacular of the word into sort of PACE. So PACE is prepare, you know, we can get into that a little bit. You know, A is apply, C is commit, and E is evaluate. So you look at E, I have some examples in the books and say, look, if you're in a certain point in your career and you want to evaluate where you are you, again, in the right role, in the right company, should you make a move, right? There aren't a lot of people in the workforce that are staying at the same company like our parents did for 30 years and then collect the pension, you know, when they're 55 or 58. So it is a different world that we're in. And you brought up a good point, Lou. You know, right now it's the convergence of all these generations in the workforce, right? The baby boomers are retiring, the Gen Xers like you and me, I'm assuming you're a Gen Xer, you know, Gen Ys, you know, and millennials. And now the next generation's coming up too. So it's an interesting challenge for everyone. And no one's really kind of figured out how to solve sort of that melting pot of all these generational workers.
If I look at that process, by the way, and I like the breakdown. I'm always a big fan of acronyms. As these young professionals are trying to figure out where to go and what to do, how much of your process is about them figuring out maybe what they do well at one skill or what they do themselves, or helping them to assess what else is out there within the space so that they can explore and learn and try and figure out if that's an avenue for me to pivot to or for me to jump to? Explain maybe a little bit about what your thinking is and how you're helping the young professional prepare.
Yeah, finding a job's not easy, right? I mean, you know, you have all these online tools, whether it's Indeed or Monster, and they all have these incredible algorithms that can just, you know, eliminate a lot of applicants, right? Keyword searches, all that good stuff. Not going to really get into the technical part of it, but what the book talks about is some of the grassroots, simple, you know, things that you should think about when you go on an interview, right? Again, your personal executive presence, your persona, you know, are your social media platforms cleaned up, right? You don't want to have party photos on your Instagram, because if you want to interview someone for a job, what's the first thing you're going to do? You're going to check them on a LinkedIn, check them on an Instagram. You know, maybe you go to their Facebook or maybe even you dig deeper and go to their TikTok, and there's things that are inappropriate. You know, you're eliminated, right? Resume, cover letter, interview skills, all these things that we take for granted, you have to have all polished and ready to go. So when you actually prepare yourself, you got to ensure that you're set and you're going to represent yourself in the best way possible. You got to have that elevator speech, you know, all that stuff, right? So research on the company, you know, very important. You know, you just throw in your resume to 10 different tech companies because you think you want to be in tech, or did you really research the values and what the company is all about? So you got to actually do that preparation up front.
I love asking authors this question. I want to see where this goes, Mark. When you wrote this book, you had an intention of who was going to benefit from this. And these are the target audience that this book is geared towards. But what I've learned from every author that I've ever spoken to on Thrive Loud is that there's this happy accident, or almost like a gift that shows up for the author, something in when they put this book together in the process. Was there? a gift for you in putting together the PACE process? And how was the process of putting this book together for you?
Well, it was always a bucket list item for me. And over, you know, the pandemic, I had some free time evenings and nights. And I just, and that's when I kind of, you know, started putting pencil to paper, right? Just sort of writing my thoughts and ideas. And so when it came to fruition, I was going to self-publish. And then a friend of mine who was an editor took a look at it and said, I'm going to send this to a couple publishers. And then I had a couple publishers that bid on the book. And I'm like, wow, that's kind of interesting and flattering at the same time. So we went through that process and it was published in April and it was a bestseller, you know, the first week in a couple of categories. And I was really humbled by that. And, you know, really the, my network, friends, family, all sort of surrounded me and said, hey, Mark, this is really good stuff for my kids or my nephews, my nieces. And I was fortunate that it was released at a time where people were graduating from college and going into the workforce. So it was a good gift for sort of that college grad that was looking for a job or kind of didn't know quite what they wanted to do. And the book's really taken off. Again, it's I don't want to sit here and say how many we've sold, but we've sold a few thousand anyway. And, awesome. And so I'm totally humbled and flattered by it. And now what I'm looking at is, okay, how can I continue to help people, whether it's with the book or through my role or, you know, through learning and development, you know, which is what I'm still involved in. So I don't know if that answers your question, but it just sort of, it went further along than I actually thought it was going to when I, you know, when I first started writing it.
That was the gift, I guess, in this, or let's put it this way. There's still an opportunity potentially out there for whatever this pace might be at your own pace of what this gift could be for you and might emerge in different ways, like speaking opportunities or great podcasts or all these other things or connecting with great people about it. See, exactly. I've told you there's a gift in this somewhere in there, Mark.
You're 100% correct.
All right. So before we go down Fun Street, I don't want to leave all this stuff out. You have a lot of hats. I opened up with them and all the different roles that you have. And obviously you have new hats because now you're an author and now you're marketing yourself and you're putting together all these different things. You wear a lot of them. If you have to choose which hat you like to wear the most with all the things that you do, which one of those roles and responsibilities or job titles or actions do you like doing most?
Well, that's a great question. I love having a couple of balls in the air, right? So the hat cliche is a good one, but I like to do a bunch of different things, right? I'm an entrepreneur and kind of as long as the balls keep going, and I have a great role with ELB Learning. I sold my learning and development business earlier in the year, and I was fortunate to have a great company that I combined with, and I'm doing some commercial sales for them, and it's going great, right? So I have that piece, and then obviously I have the book piece and I'm being asked to speak and I've been on a half dozen podcasts and this is a lot of fun as well. So again, I'm just trying to figure out what the next chapter is long-term, right? We're still in the same year where sold my business, had a TEDx talk, wrote a book. So a lot of stuff going on. And again, I feel really fortunate that I have these options and opportunities and we'll kind of see where they go.
Like it. Let's do the admin part of the show, Mark. Share with the listeners all the people, all the places people can learn about you, websites, URLs, handles, where they can get the book. We'll put it all in the show notes, but it always gets more engagement when they hear it from you.
Yeah. So, you know, you can follow me on Instagram at markzides.pace or, I have a Twitter handle, mzides. My website's markzides.com. So those are probably, or LinkedIn is probably, a good spot to connect with me if you're looking to, collaborate or connect. So those are really the places. If you just Google my name, all those handles and those locations come up.
Mark Zides, you ready to go down Fun Street?
Yes, sir.
All right. First of all, share with the listeners what I already know, but you need to share with them is one of your all-time favorite movies.
It was a tough question when you asked me in the pre-work to come up with one, but Hoosiers is the answer.
Okay, so why does that movie connect so much with you?
So it's a sports movie, which I love the genre of that, and it's got a dozen or so messages or experiences or actions in there that sort of hit home to me, being kind of an old school tough love type guy, and that's why I love it. Love Gene Hackman kind of leading it and all the players, in the story.
I'm now going to ask another question since we're about the same age and this thing aired enough on cable to literally, burn out the wires. How many times do you think you've seen even just a slice of that movie, like if it happened to be on, you had to jump in. How many times would you ballpark it?
A few dozen.
I think mine's closer to 50. And there's still one scene to me that doesn't make any sense, Mark. It's right at the end of the game. They're coming up with the last play, and Hackman tries to go and make another decision. And when he makes the decision, what it is, all the players back up. Like, give the ball to Jimmy.
Right.
But their reaction is so strange. And it's like, what's the matter with you guys? Which I think he just needed to get into the movie because Gene Hackman loves to say that line in a lot of other movies. But anyway, it is a classic and I do like it. And the music is epic within it. I actually got a chance to go to Butler and go to where they play that game in the arena. And they have a very specific sign on there that says you're not allowed to go on the court and mimic the shot.
Oh, wow. Really?
That's well, cool. Specifically around game time, they put on a thing. Please don't try to imitate Jimmy Chipwood while you're here. Something like
right.
that.
So. Yeah.
Yeah, all right.
Picket fence. Yeah. I mean, again, in that one scene, you know, we talk about, it's like, I'll take the shot. Right. No. So that to me is like, he has the, you know what, to make the statement, and then he makes it. Right. So, and it's a true story. So that it's all that kind of, you know, works into, hey, in life, you got to take chances. You got to take shots. Right. What was it that Michael Jordan said? I'm going to blow this, but you know, you can't hit shots you don't take, or something like that. Or you know, he made some. So I love all those kind of sport cliches.
Love it. We're going to do the speed round here, Mark. Here's how it works. I'm going to ask you something, and all I want is the first thing that comes to your mind. Most of these things are things that lift you up, make you feel good. They basically make you thrive. You ready to roll?
Ready.
Okay. Of late, a song that you've been listening to, or maybe one that pumps you up?
Under Pressure.
The Under Pressure. Now, which version?
Queen and Bowie.
David Bowie. Yeah. Okay, the original, as opposed to something more modern. Okay.
Yeah.
A favorite food that is not a dessert.
Meatballs.
Ooh. Favorite dessert.
Apple pie.
An activity you wish you did more of.
Basketball.
An activity you wish you did less of.
Work.
If I could snap my fingers and Mark Zides could be anywhere in the world, where is he?
With my kids on a tropical island. Oh, and my wife, obviously. Wife and kids.
Oh, yeah. Her, too. Yeah. Just a quick curiosity question. You're still playing basketball? Are you getting a run in there? Are you just shooting around? Nope.
I don't do it, so I should have said golf. But okay. You know, that's the one that came to mind because we had the whole basketball theme going. So.
Gotcha. Well, what I will say is there used to be a game that they play around here with other, let's just say Gen Xers or older, on Tuesday nights. And I there were just too many bruises and elbows that I ended up getting hit with or hurting either way. Just kept me out of the game for it. I'll just let the kids take it on. But
yeah, you and me both. But if I could change my answer, I'd say golf, because my friends all bust my chops. They say, you know, you should be playing more golf. And my excuse is I just have no time because I have all these balls in the air. So that's what I like to play more of, I guess.
I love it. Mark Zides, everybody check it out. Pace Process. We'll put all the links in the show notes for you here. Truly a pleasure to have you on the show, man. Thank you for what you're doing. And I know our younger listeners truly appreciate it because they're going to be able to figure out how to succeed at their own pace. So thanks for coming on.
Thanks, Lou. Fun time. Appreciate it.
You got it. And to all our listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep moving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright. Be gone.
Listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Check us out on the web at thriveloud.com and follow us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook at Thrive Loud. And check us out on the Good Pods app at Thrive Loud, where you can follow, listen, and connect directly to Lou and all of the Thrive Loud episodes. Thanks for listening.